Greetings and welcome. We are in Senior English A, and our objective now for the hour is to address Francis Bacon, the life of the great British philosopher, writer, statesman, and also to pay particular attention to one of his classic essays of studies. Let's begin, first of all, with Bacon himself. Bacon is in many ways a child of the English Renaissance. He is a contemporary of Shakespeare. And are you ready for this? There are, in fact, debates which occur after Bacon's life that Shakespeare did not actually write the plays attributed to Shakespeare, but they were, in fact, written by someone else. Someone else? Who someone else? Well, the argument went something like this, dubious as it is, most likely it went something like this. There ain't no way that a cat who was given the public education that Shakespeare was given as a child, there ain't no way that he could write the plays that are ascribed to his name. To write those plays, you would have to have someone who was highly, highly educated, had been given all of the advantages of private tutoring in geography alone, to be able to know all the stuff he knows in the some 36 plus plays that are attributed to Shakespeare. Ergo, Shakespeare himself was a name associated with the successful writer of these plays who did not want to be known. He wished to be remain anonymous, okay? And with that in mind, who could that person be? Well, there aren't a lot of people to choose from who fit the rubric of highly, highly educated. Francis Bacon is one of them. By the age of 13, he already has his PhD, speaks 7 different languages. This cat is brilliant, absolutely brilliant. Okay, in almost every discipline, this guy has tremendous range of knowledge. On top of that, he is a traveler. Why? Well, he's kind of like Chaucer was. He's kind of like an ambassador. So he travels around Europe, speaking all of these languages, reading all these different texts in their original languages, and therefore, he is well known. But we're not finished. Not only is Bacon important as a philosopher, as a statesman, really, he's most important as a scientist. Today, if you journey down the hall there, and you walk into one of our biology or physics classrooms, you will immediately hear about what we call today the scientific method. In other words, if you wish to gain answers to difficult questions, you have a process that you follow that runs something like this. You begin with some kind of a hypothesis, that is to say, an idea of how things will work out, a potential solution. However, before you can ascribe any faith, real conviction, in that solution, you must engage in a form of data collection, what we will call testing or research. Once we research, we collect data, that data will either confirm or not confirm our hypothesis. Now, as I speak to you about this, you almost roll your eyes like, yeah, and it gets dark at night and the sun comes up in the morning. How could anyone not know that process? The answer, of course, is, yeah, that ain't the way it worked before Bacon. No kidding. For example, if you had serious problems in your stomach, you call the medic in, he would arrive at your house, only he had to be there in the evening for his first consultation. Why the evening? Because he was going to walk out the door and look up at the stars. No kidding. I'm not done yet. He would look at the stars for a while and the arrangement of the planets and stars. He would then walk back into the room, he would look at you and say, it's fairly obvious what our problems are. Then he would take out a tool, it's difficult to call it a tool, it's actually more like a torture mechanism. And it fit on the bottom of your feet with screws that would screw into the bottom of your feet, where there would be a dime size or smaller hole that would then be put in the bottom of your feet, where blood would then obviously come out. This bloodletting made all the sense in the world because, of course, the reason you're sick is you have heavy blood and it's floating to the bottom of your body. If you can get rid of all that blood, then you will be well. Oh, by the way, you need to pay me now because people of my, patients of mine have a tendency to not wake up the next morning, you can imagine. This is what medicine is before Bacon. There's no such thing as experimentation. You simply make up stuff and everybody goes, okay. Bacon is the first in a long line who will challenge through what we call the inductive method. In other words, he looks at data, and from that data, he draws conclusions which will validate or invalidate a hypothesis. Are you ready for this? Bacon is doing research on meat spoiling. He's in his backyard. It's the winter. They're still on the ground. And he's got a bunch of dead chickens. I'm not making this up. Dead chickens lying around. Some of those chickens are completely under the snow. Others are barely covering. And he has these bodies of chickens all the way into his house, up next to the fire. He has his little clipboard. Of course, if you've spent any time in a science classroom, you know what he's doing. He's conducting research. It's a lab, isn't it? Where he's studying how long it takes for meat to deteriorate, to spoil, right? I can just imagine what, you know, the next door neighbors must have thought, you know, Harriet with her hair in rollers talking to her husband about Francis is in the backyard doing crazy again. And sure enough, he's clipping, you know, all this marking off on his little clipboard. Sometime in the evening, he starts to cough. Later that early morning, he's in his bed with the chills. A few days later, he's dead. When Stanford wanted to know before the IQ tests made so famous by Wishkobinet, when Stanford wanted to know, gee, who is probably the smartest cats that ever lived before we had an IQ test? They invented a software program and they kicked all this data into the software program and then waited for a month. And at the end of it, it kicked out names in which the software suggested that probably the smartest people who ever lived before we had the advantage of IQ tests were the following, and it made the list. The first one was the German, great German writer Goethe, and number two was Francis Bacon, and they were in close 1-2 with each other. Are you ready for this? The smartest cat supposedly who ever lived died stuffing chickens with snow. I also have a mnemonic for you, Mr. Keeley. From this point on, you can always remember Bacon by simply remembering eggs and bacon. Okay, because eggs come from chickens. I felt I needed to explain it one more time. Okay, so there we go. That's Francis Bacon. Now, what makes Bacon so important, by the way, when the Royal Society of Scientists are formed in England? It is Francis Bacon whose name they will give the great kind of lofty position as being the inventor in many ways of this idea that you are going to create a university. What an amazing notion. The idea that you would create a university where research is done, right? Because in Bacon's day, if, for example, Mr. Durant sitting there during my exciting lecture were to fall down on the floor and foam starts coming out of his mouth or something, immediately all of the people involved would assume there's some kind of demonic possession going on, and everybody would just go, oh, that's what's going on. It's not till Bacon that Bacon asked the simple question, gee, why don't we just do a little bit of research, find out what's wrong with Durant, and maybe we can keep this from happening either to him or to somebody else. What an idea, what a concept. For example, your eye starts kind of getting cloudy and you can't see out of it very well, okay? It never occurred to people pre-Bacon to actually say, let's investigate the eyeball and see how it works. Isn't that fascinating? That wasn't even in their mindset. It will be Bacon who in many ways invents this idea. Most importantly for your notes and for our conversation now, however, are you ready for this? Bacon invents the essay. Yeah, now Mr. Frank says if there's anyone to whom you wish to hurl insults, please, not Mr. McGee, you can just claim it and lay it all at Bacon's feet. In many ways, he invents the essay as you understand it today. The essay in which you have a prescribed kind of idea that you want to present through a series of lines, sentences, paragraphs. Bacon's collected essays become some of the best reading of the day. Okay, think roughly 1660 or so. And so Bacon's essay of studies is kind of held out as one of those classic examples. What does it mean to be a good student? What does it mean to study? Why should we study? Every eighth grader that you've ever known, probably including yourself, asked in the middle of a math lecture in eighth grade, why do we ever have to learn this crap? When will we ever use it? You know, these kinds of questions. Bacon says that is the most important question of your school career. That question that usually got thrown away into the garbage can with the famous mantra, because I said so, from the teacher. Bacon, one of the most brilliant men who ever lived, said, there is no more important question than the simple question, why should I ever study anything? What's the point of it? And he will write a classic essay called Of Studies, where he's going to outline this for us. Now, unfortunately, given my time, I can't go into this essay in full detail. However, we can get through enough of this to get a sense of what it is he's working with. Mr. Nelson, in his fine reading voice, will begin here in a moment for us to read. Now, as he does so, right away, I'm going to predict that I will be interrupting him, and I'll be on the whiteboard. I'm going to help you annotate this thing, especially the opening line. Study stir for delight, for ornament, for ability. Go ahead and begin for us, Mr. Nelson, at the beginning.
Studies serve for delight, for ornament, and for ability.
And what I'm going to do right away, notice that I'm going to begin to make some kind of a chart, because I realize right away, and I'm teaching you how to read as you get ready for university college training. Right away, I notice that he's working in trinities. He's working in threes, right? So, for example, he will tell me, studies serve, that is to say they're good for, and then I'm going to put his language first, for delight, for ornament, and for ability, right? And then notice their chief use. Go ahead.
Their chief use for delight is in privateness and retirement.
Now, see, I realize what he's done. What he's done is he's told me studies are good for three things. First for delight, then for ornament, and then for ability. Then he's going to come back and explain to me what he means by delight. And so I start to make a little chart or a little grid for myself. And he says, and I'm always going to start with his language first and then put my own language, as in, what did he say it was? Privateness and retiring. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a little line there. And I'm going to try and put my own language to figure out what it is he's talking about. Privateness and retiring. Study is good for privateness and retiring. Dude, what does that mean? I mean, I know what retiring means today when they give you a watch and tell you, nice job, you can leave 303 now. I know what in NASCAR it means to retire, that is to say, put new tires on your vehicle. But what does it mean when Bacon says studies are useful for retiring? And some of you maybe have an old grandma or somebody that every once in a while would say something like this in the evening. Well, I think it's time for me to retire. What does that mean? Yeah, go to bed, or more particularly, to be alone. In other words, Bacon says studies are really useful for when you're by yourself. That way you're not bored. Right? Now notice, he hasn't told us what studies are yet. We'll get to that in a bit. What he's going to do first is tell us, you know what's the value of studying first? If you're all by yourself, you at least have some way to fill your time. As a few years ago, a young senior asked me, okay, McGee, give it to me straight. What is it that the human existence is all about? And I said, well, that's a heavy question, but I can answer it this way. It's simply answering the question, how will I fill my hours? Day after day. What am I going to do with all that time that I've got? That is the penultimate question. Bacon says you're going to find a lot of that time you're all alone and by yourself instead of just passing time with video games, which will become for us in our generation the new, right? I mean, Bacon had no idea of video games. What Bacon's video games were a book. Today, of course, video games serve the same purpose in large measure, right? That is to say, they give you something to do when you're all by yourself, which, by the way, happens regularly, right? So studies serve for delight. Now, what is this thing called ornament? Now, I know what it is on a Christmas tree when they put ornaments on a Christmas tree. What is it, Mr. Nelson, he says about ornaments in regards to what?
For ornament is in discourse.
What does discourse mean? If I'm having a discourse, for example, with, well, yeah, conversation. So I draw a little line here, and I put conversation, right? Now, what does that mean? ornament. I understand you put an ornament on a Christmas tree for what reason? You celebrate it? Show off. Let's put it on. That's brilliant. That's the word. Show off. In other words, to decorate the tree, right? Well, now, wait a minute. Can you decorate your speaking? See, now the answer Bacon gives is, you bet you can. You bet you can. Now, I pause here for a moment, and I have every year I've ever lectured this essay for many years to make an observation. It's a biographic piece of information, and I don't do this a lot, but I will confide to you, I was not raised primarily in the United States. As a young boy, I traveled much outside the United States and lived often outside the United States. So when I came back to America, I was impressioned at a very young age by how strange Americans are. Strange in what way? Well, it's kind of like this. I can point it out to you this way. Americans are very strange. And here's what I think why. And I figured this out early on. Think of it this way. Americans are some of the only people on earth that if I stand in front of them and I begin to speak, for example, I'll talk like this. The minute that I begin to speak like this, some of you will immediately assume I'm highly intelligent, even though the truth is I might be quite stupid. On the other hand, I talk like this, y'all think I'm about as dumb as can be, somewhere out there around Lubbock or somewhere like that, even though I have a couple of PhDs, y'all figure I've got to be about as stupid as can be. Amazing. Now, I should point out to you, Americans are the only culture I ever contacted that are like that, that make assumptions about people dependent upon the way they speak. Let me give you a classic example. You're sitting in that office waiting for that job to come, you know, that interview, and sure enough, you make it. The big desk, the guy sitting behind it, you walk in, and the guy says to you in the course of the conversation, what are your thoughts about your salary? Now, that's a setup question. I can help you in advance. That's a setup question. You never want to wade into that one. What you want to be able to do is to say to the gentleman, or the woman who's doing the hiring, I'll leave it up to you. But what if you were to turn around to the individual who just asked you about your salary and say, you know what, I'm going to leave the emolument issue up to you. Now, here's the problem with what you just did. Emolument just means salary. That's all it means. But here's the problem. The guy hiring you is the one with the power, right? You have no power. You're trying to get the job. But the minute you use the word emolument, and he doesn't know that it means salary, he can't ask you what emolument means. He can't go, emolument? What's emolument? He can't do that. Because the minute that he asks you that, you know something he doesn't know, now you have more power. Mm-hmm. Right? So what is it that he does? He lets you leave the room. He takes out his little dictionary that he got with his encyclopedia set for free. He opens to the word emolument. He sees that it means salary. And he immediately assumes what about you? You're he immediately smart. Assumes you're brilliant. Of course, you might have been sitting out reading a Reader's Digest in a foyer 25 seconds before you came in the room. You know how they do that thing where they give you the word lists? And you saw, oh, emolument, it means salary. Gee, I think I'll try and use that one today. And that's the first time you ever use the word, and he assumes, and he gives you the... See how that works? Bacon says, if you study, you have the ability to do this project called impress. Impress. And in the end, that is a great challenge for us in a world where you live by making money, right? You have to be able to impress people. I mean, I'm often asked, okay, what's the biggest challenge for me growing up in a small community of less than 6,000 people? And one of the answers to that, there are many advantages, obviously, to that. But one of the disadvantages to growing up in a community like this is that very, very rarely do you ever have to walk up to a complete and total stranger, put out your hand and introduce yourself. Hi, I'm so-and-so, and I'm from this place. Who are you? Most of you have never done that in your whole life. The people you work for, you knew them, they knew you, families knew families. Your whole life has been like this. You don't know strangers, and if you know strangers, you have a tendency to kind of stand back. The rest of your life, however, and unless, of course, you never leave the confines of this community, the rest of your life will be about meeting people who you've never known before. How will you impress them? Bacon says, vocabulary is not bad. However, are you ready for this? Bacon argues you can overdo the vocab thing. You can overdo it. You have to know how to use it. I like to think of it this way. So now you know that the word emolument means pay, right? But here's the point. Sometimes you want to use the words vocabulary. Other times you don't want to use the words. Now this one reminds me of a great commercial I love to tell about. It's the famous Porsche commercial. For those of you who don't know, Porsche is a classic automobile. And there used to be this great commercial that they had that I always think about at this moment in my lecture. A gentleman well-dressed with his little bow tie driving in a brand new Porsche out in the middle of nowhere that looks kind of like the place we live. You know how they do that where there's a stoplight? And he plays nice classical music, pulls up to the stoplight, it's red. All of a sudden on the music backtrack, there's this like really heavy metal, like Metallica music. And then all of a sudden next to him comes up this Camaro, the American car Camaro. And inside are a bunch of kids and the music's really loud and smoke's coming out the windows because they're all smoking on the inside. And one of the guys inside the car does this to the guy in the Porsche. He's challenging him. The light change, nothing's been said. The light change in this commercial, nothing's been said. The light changes from red to green. The entire screen up with smoke, and then as the smoke starts to fade, the classical music comes back up. The Camaro is gone. You cannot see it. It's gone. The well-dressed gentleman engages his car, slowly pulls away. Nothing's been said. The screen goes black, letters come up, words, and it says the following. The power is in knowing. You don't always have to use it. Porsche, there is no substitute. Now, follow what that commercial says. That guy sitting in that car, he knows that he could dust this group with this group of kids, okay? He's aware of that. He doesn't have to do it because he knows already. That's the power of having good vocabulary. That's the power of learning things. That's the power of the question, why do I gotta learn this crap? The third category, in ability, as in money. What I love about Bacon is he's very practical and he says the following for your notes. He says, look, you gotta feed yourself. The best way to do that is to know enough so that you have skill sets other people maybe don't have as well. So gain as much knowledge as you can so that you can then turn around and translate that into money. I love that Bacon, who's a cat we're told could sit for 10, 11 straight hours and read in a library. He was a complete and total bookworm. And yet he's the one that argues in this essay, knowledge don't mean crap if you can't turn it into bank. You got to be able to make money with your knowledge. I pause here often and will point out to students, suggestion, you got to live the next 10 years of your life anyway. Why not go ahead and devote the next 10 years of your life and all of your energies to trying to find the very best education that you can get? While everybody else at the university is partying, you work and save all of your money. No matter what your major is, at least take one class in investment of money. At least one. So that you can let somebody teach you how to take the small amount of money that you make and you can invest it in the stock market so that by the end of 4 or 5 years, you can do what one of my old students did and walked in and just paid cash for his brand new car. They thought he was a dope dealer. He said, I'm no dope dealer. While everybody else was partying on Friday night, I was working. And then I was also studying because while everybody else was blowing their money at college, I was saving mine. I invested it. Are you familiar with the stock market? It's an amazing thing what you can do if you study it. I'm now paying you in cash. There it is. Now the answer to the question, what will I do in life for Bacon is, live. That's what you'll do. But to live, you have to have money. And to have money, you have to have a job. And to have a job means one of two things. You're either going to run the company or work at the company. Think of it this way. If at the age of 5, your ma, your dad, whoever was responsible for you, had said, we got 30 days in the summer. We're going to travel anywhere in the world you want to go, and for 30 days, we're going to enjoy it. We're going to eat the cuisine. We're going to travel. What if that had happened for you every summer from the time you were 5? Question, what kind of person would you be different than you are right now? Question, listen. You have an opportunity someday to have a child of your own at 5. If you play your game right, see, that's the point of Bacon. If you play your game right, you got the money. You can say to your five-year-old, we got 30 days, what do you want to do? Let's go. We'll go somewhere. We'll see the world. So that by the time your child is your age, your child will have opportunities you never had because of this. Bacon, finally in this essay, write it down, will define studies as three things: reading, writing, and speaking. He will say, if you can do those three things well, then you have a chance to be very successful in life. I've had students that listen to this essay and say, you know, I think this guy's actually right. I basically spent my whole life in school thinking about school as the place where they do nasty things to me. Stupid teachers give me this stupid work that I have to do, blah, blah, blah. At some point, Bacon says, if you can reinvent the view so that school is where you do things for yourself, it's an opportunity. And of course, in the greatest country in the history of the world, of course, is the one you live in. And if you look at the great minds, the ones, the inventors, they were the ones who learned how to use school to their own advantage. About any subject, never say, when will I ever use this? Because you don't know the future. You don't know when it's going to call. Hey, some of you sat in an ACT test or an ASVAB test, and you had to admit, in eighth grade, if I had known this, eighth grade mathematics would have been a different study for me. Right? So going forward, whatever it is that you're studying or doing, and by the way, Bacon is the one to point out, education is not school. School is one small slice of education. Education is everything. The jobs that you've had, the people that you've met, the places that you go. Thank you. Come back tomorrow. We'll work some more.